And for the Million More Movement in 2005, we performed, we opened up the stage. We also thank Masjidullah and the imams and the entire staff for having us to come and perform and open up this stage and celebrate our Ramadan. So thank you all. May Allah continue to bless you and have a great evening.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give another round of applause to the Universal African Dance and Drum Ensemble. We'd like to welcome you all here today. Right now, we're going to introduce the mistress and mister of ceremonies, Sister Nissa Islam Muhammad and Brother Ali Salahuddin. Please welcome them with a nice round of applause.
Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you and welcome to Masjidullah's 2014 Pre-Ramadan Banquet. Please give yourselves a warm round of applause. Masjidullah has established this as an annual event on the Saturday before Ramadan. And our theme this year is reconciliation. And we're so excited to have so many Muslims here from so many different communities that we can begin to continue the reconciliation of our family. The theme of reconciliation is bringing a family back together. And we're calling the human family back to its original nature of excellence. The descendants of Adam have been so fragmented with labels and terms and concepts that do more to disunify and distract than they do to unite. And so the Holy Quran says, "We have made you into tribes and nations that you may know one another, not that you may hate and despise one another." Tonight, we want to get to know one another better and reconcile the human family. We're especially looking forward to the reconciliation and working together of the Masjidullah family and the brothers and sisters of the Nation of Islam. Masjidullah grew out of the Nation of Islam under the leadership of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. After his departure in 1975, Imam W.D. Muhammad was named leader of the Nation of Islam. When he transitioned the community, Masjidullah transitioned with him. This evening, we come together as one nation, as one family, as one Nation of Islam. We come together as one Nation of Islam and former members of the Nation of Islam. We come together under the best title as Muslims. We are Muslims with each other and brothers and sisters together in other faith traditions. And so we all come together tonight as one humanity, giving praises to the one creator of all humanity. Please give yourselves another warm round of applause.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I wish you all could just see yourselves the way I'm looking. This is just a beautiful audience. It's been a long time coming, but we're back. Family is back together. I wish we could play that song by the OJ's family. Where's Kenny at? Family reunion. Family's back together. Before we have our award presentation, we just have a few little housekeeping things that we wanted to go over. First of all, we want to thank everybody for coming out, supporting Masjidullah's annual Pre-Ramadan Banquet. We're so happy to have the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan as our guest speaker tonight. But one of the main reasons that we have come here tonight is because, as you know, about a year ago, we were blessed to purchase the West Oak Lane Church of God in Christ. And now that has become Masjidullah's new home, the Center for Human Excellence. We paid $1 million for the facility. In the last year, we put about another $500,000 in renovations. Since we opened in January, our attendance has doubled. And but what we need to do now is that we need to buy the parking lot that's across the street from the new mosque, because we want to be good neighbors. And we don't want to be parking our cars in front of the houses and the businesses. So we have to have a parking lot that goes along with the facility. So we're hoping that tonight that you'll help us as we move forward and you hear more about what we're going to do. Now, as we move forward in tonight's program, there's a couple of things that we are asking you to please be mindful of. Number one, photos are not to be taken of Minister Farrakhan. Masjidullah has hired several photographers to take pictures, and they are the only ones authorized to take pictures of Minister Farrakhan. Our security and hostesses have been instructed to identify those who violate this request and to escort the offender out of the ballroom. Your attendance at this banquet is acceptance of all procedures set by the committee. We know that we can count on you to follow these procedures so that everybody can enjoy the evening. Now, this event is being live streamed. So that means, in addition to you here in the facility, people from around the world are watching this event. So people from Europe, Central and South America, Africa, all over the world are watching this, what we consider a historic event. So this is something that you may not realize what's happening now, but this is something that years in the future, you'll be proud to say that I was there when this happened. In addition to being live streamed, we have what we call our Twitter army. So over to the left, we have about 10 brothers and sisters that are tweeting this as we move forward. So this message is going out all over the world right now that the Muslims in America have come together to take their rightful place. Now, the restrooms are located off of the hallway outside of the ballroom. So when you go out these doors, you'll see the restrooms on the far wall. Okay, so now at this point, what we're going to do, I'm going to call up to the microphone the resident imam of Masjidullah, Imam Mikhail Shabazz, and he's going to open the program with a dua. Imam Mikhail.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وانظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون لا يستوي أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشئا متصديا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عليم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله خالق بارئ مسوئ الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم صدق الله العظيم
Brothers and sisters, at this time, we'd like to bring forward our beloved brother Imam Emeritus of Masjidullah, Imam Muhammad Abdul Alim. He will be presenting the 2014 Walk the Walk Pioneer Award.
Assalamu alaikum. With God's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful Redeemer. We give praise and thanks to Allah for blessing us to be here tonight. We want to thank all of you for your coming. We hope that you come to be a part of something special. We hope you come to make a contribution to something that will live long after we all are gone. Now I have the distinct honor of giving what we call Walk the Walk Award. Now, I have a script here that they want me to follow, but I'm hard-pressed to do these things. So I put it on my iPad so I can make sure that I stick with most of the main points anyway. What we have here is an award that for people who not only talk the talk, because a lot of people can talk the talk. You know, they with you, but when it comes time to throwing down, they ain't there. So these people here that I'm going to be announcing, there are two. We call them the ones who go out front, the vanguard, those ones who go when no other people will help you. These ones will be there for you. And the first of these people is the sister that I met when I first came to Philadelphia, Sister Fatima Ali. All right? Yes, ma'am. And just to show you how serious my relationship with her, she took on my family when I first came here. And in her honor, not only did we give her this award, but I named my daughter named our latest grandchild after her. Because here's a sister, at any time, a day or night, you call on her, she comes to help. Right? She makes no excuses. Now she's up in age now, but she's still working harder than a lot of the young people who got a lot of Quran and Arabic, but no work. Right? They talk the talk, but they don't walk the walk. Sister Fatima, come up here, please. Here is a sister who has served as the leader of the Muslim girl training. Here's a sister who has served in our schools. Here's a sister who has served on every committee helping to uplift the fallen humanity, whether they Muslim or not. Here's a sister who knows no bounds when it comes to serving the human family, right? And I have a whole list of things I want to say, but the main thing I want to say is that this sister loves God. And any day you ask her, how is it going? She always says, I'm grateful. She never complains. I can ask her, and this is one person that can come to my house when I got all kind of attitude. They, brother, ma'am, you got to come out here and get these people straight. And she always said, I'm grateful. So I want to bring up to you my sister, Sister Fatima Ali, who's been almost as hard on me as my mother over there in terms of making me stay straight. Sister Fatima, will you please say a few words, please? You know I love you, right?
Once again, alhamdulillah. I can't do nothing without him. I'm telling you, I started out this morning at 8:30. And I said, oh God, I got that banquet tonight. But Allah is so kind. He's so merciful. And I do want to thank each and every one that was involved, who selected my name. I only do what my heart tells me to do. And I am now 48. You can turn it around. I'm 84.
We're working out. We're working out.
So, once again, Shakran, thank you. And as long as Allah give me the breath and I have the strength, I will do whatever I can. As-salamu alaykum.
Assalamu alaikum, again. The next person who we gave this award to is the brother who I've had the pleasure of traveling actually all over the world with, Brother Samir Muhammad, actually Haji. This brother and I have had the opportunity. He is the brother who is the family man, a businessman, a person who anytime you call him day or night, he's also one of these ones who walk the walk. My brother, Samir Muhammad. Where's Samir anyway? Come on up here, brother. Don't be hiding now. Come on up. This brother and I said again, we've had the opportunity to travel many places and have many, many night arguments called steel shopping steel. All right, I bump heads with him all the time, but you know I love him. This brother, you got your award? I want to present to you, Samir. I want you to accept this award as one who has lit the torch. You are my brother, and you know that.
Yes, sir.
But as brothers, we fight a lot.
Yes, sir, brother.
But it doesn't take away from your work.
Yes, sir.
Because many days you had my back.
Yes, sir, brother.
When we were in some heated situations.
Yes, we have.
That's right. And I want to make sure that before you leave this earth, I say before the public, I love this man. Because a lot of people can't go where we went. And I told him, I said, we get to Mecca, if we serve the people, they will serve us. The elderly people in Mecca, we help them kiss the black stone, and what happened? They let us kiss the black stone. They opened up for us. Out of millions of people, his brother and I were together. So, but he had Masjidullah, and this brother here has both legs. He loves God, he also loves money. No, it's very important. See, a lot of that idea that spiritualism takes you away from economics. We at Masjidullah, we insist on being balanced. Here, my brother, I want to present to you this walk, because in order to walk, you need both legs.
Yes, sir,
brother. Economics and spiritual. So say a few words, please.
I will. I was so, assalamu alaikum. I bear witness that there's no God but Allah, and I bear witness that Prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah is the last prophet of God. I just want to say to you, I'm so happy. I've been around here a long time, man. Everybody who my friends, please stand up. All my friends. I'm talking about people that love me. Alhamdulillah. Y'all make me want to cry. These are my buddies. You know what I'm saying? These are my true friends. And I want to let all of y'all. I got my two beautiful daughters right here. I love y'all, man. I just want to say something to y'all, man. The life that I lived when I came into this religion in 1969, I came into this deen. And the thing that I found out, man, you must cling to Allah. You must love God. You must love the Prophet. If you want character, if you want personality, man, give your life to Allah. I bear witness in my own personal life. Lonnie Ali texted me a few days ago, said, Samir, tell Farouk, Lonnie Ali is Muhammad Ali's wife, the champion of the world, personal friend of mine for 35 years. I'm talking about character. I'm talking about loving God. She said, Samir, tell Farouk. Brother Farouk stands. Brother Farouk in that audience? Y'all know Farouk Afar, a beautiful brother that loves God. She said, Samir, tell Farouk that me and you are friends forever.
Allahu Akbar.
Character. I had two powerful lawyers come from South Africa, because I was there in 1992. Muhammad Ali Gilani asked me to go over there and speak for him for 30 days. And I talked to groves of people, thousands of people. And I told them to worship God and pray and get knowledge and make money. I was a spokesperson for Muhammad Ali. And because of that, 20 years later, two sharp lawyers came to America looking for me. And we sat down for two or three days, hashing out a hell of a contract. Samir Muhammad ain't finished high school. I had a personal relationship with Imam Wazir Muhammad. He called me, I called him, and Michael Rashid is a witness when Imam Muhammad said, Brother Samir, you know I value your opinion. Now, how better can you get these powerful people? And I was yesterday at Juma, I'm going to cut it short. I was at Juma, and I saw the Honorable Louis Farrakhan, and I went over to say something to him. So 10 brothers just pushed me back. Pushed me back. And then as they went outside for him to change his shoes, they changed his shoes, then I went again, they pushed me back again. Even Zacharias Smith, stop in the name of love, Samir. We ain't gonna have that here today. Back up. I said, what you talking about, Zach? Then the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is something that knows me very well. He tell the brothers to let him in. And I have the Honorable Louis Farrakhan his personal phone number.
Isn't that awesome? As-salamu alaykum. I'm a bad man. And this is my real friend. Julie called me up one day and said, Samir, I got three fingers, and you're one of my best friends. This is a scholar here. This is a heavy brother here. I said, let me go upstate. Assalamu alaikum. How's everybody feeling? Alhamdulillah, Rabbi Alameen. It's a beautiful evening, isn't it? Beautiful vibe. We're going to continue along with the same lines of presenting awards. And this time, we're going to present the Walk Youth Award. The first recipient of this award is a sister who is a second-generation Muslim. From 1981 to 84, she attended the Islamic Community Center School, which was one of the first Islamic schools in the city of Philadelphia. And after graduating from Roxborough High School, she attended Community College of Philadelphia, where she received her associate's degree in early childhood education, where she maintained a 3.74 grade point average. Law Egba. And she's just a few credits away of obtaining her bachelor's degree in early childhood education. She's a member of the Golden Key Honor Society, and her goal is to become summa cum laude. For those of you like me don't know what that means top of the clock. I mean, sorry about that. Super numero uno. She's the mother of a single mother of a 14-year-old son, and she has extensive experience in working with children, and began when she was 10 years old, started babysitting her little cousins, and she received her first paid job outside of the family, working in a family daycare center. And at that time, she realized she had a tremendous love and passion for working with children. And childcare wasn't the only field that she wanted to go into, but it was her gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she started volunteering at our madrasa program. These are children that range from age 5 to 16 years old. And she assisted one of our pioneer sisters in dealing with the little children. And then she became a full-time madrasa staff member. And she has all kinds of interests. She's now embarking upon a new journey as she joined the team of Masjidullah's Early Childcare Academy. It's my honor to bring before you the winner of the Walk the Walk Youth Award, Sister Jathia Leash. Please come forward.
Assalamu alaikum. Unlike Brother Samir, I don't have a lot of courage juice, so I'm just going to talk for a little bit. I just like to say shukran for Masjidullah for helping me to become as involved in the community as it is. It's not easy sometimes when you move back into the city and you really don't have no place to go. And I think in 2006, after my brother passed away, I moved in back into Philadelphia, and Masjidullah made me feel home. And like you do at home, you take care of the ones that you love. So I take care of the little ones while the big ones take care of me. So, and all of this I owe to my mother, who showed me how to be a part of the community, but first you have to take care of your family first. So I just like to say thank you to my mother, Sister Aisha. Because without her, I would not be who I am today. And that's it.
Let's give Sister Jaffe another well-deserved round of applause. The second 2014 Walk the Walk Youth Award is presented to a brother who is the youngest child of a wonderful, from wonderful parents. He's been a member of Masjidullah's community since birth. He's a graduate of Wickahissing High School, and he attends currently the Montgomery County Community College, and he's studying business management. The study of the religion of Al-Islam in Arabic, and indeed he was one of our wonderful Arabic students, has been the focus of his life during his tenure during the madrasa. And he attended the madrasa from age 5 to 17 years old. In addition, he was a member of the International Heritage Foundation, the Muslim Youth Association, CARE, and Masjidullah's Youth Interfaith Initiative, where he volunteered over 200 hours of community service. He's received many awards and recognition for his work in these organizations. Not long ago, he traveled to various parts of the United States and the world, and one of his most adventurous visits was to the country of China, where he served as an ambassador of the Global Youth Organization. He gives credit to the Islamic community, and in particular, to Imam Abdul Halim Hassan and yours truly for our guidance and support in his growth and development. And so at this time, it's my honor and pleasure to bring before you the 2014 Walk the Walk Youth Award to Brother Bahauddin Abdullah. I was saying to him, I remember him when he came out of his mother's womb, because my mother was there to assist in that process, and now he's taller than me.
I would like to first thank Allah, thank my mom, thank the people who have been there to support me, and I also like to thank my sister, who has always been there, even though we argue constantly and be good on each other's nerves. She's still there to support me. And I'd like to thank my brother Sean and my partner, my friend Brittany, for also being there with me as well. And it just feels very good to be honored and recognized for the work that I've done. And Brother Zachariah told me that I'm one of the people that actually is going to be leading this religion soon. So hopefully I can do well and serve you all well. Thank you. And also, I would like to thank my mother, my beautiful mother. Can you please stand? Can you please stand, Mom, please? Because without Sister Valda Abdullah, I would not be here and I would not be able to do the things I do. So I would like to thank you, Mom.
Let's give our Walk the Walk Youth Award awardees another well-deserved round of applause. And we know that you'll do us well in serving as an example of carrying the flame. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Ladies and gentlemen, enjoy this wonderful dinner that they prepared for us. And during that time, there will be a short DVD of the history of Masjidullah. Enjoy.
Several families, myself included, we put up our homes as our collateral for a building on 7700 Ogun. And this was the first time, and we did another plan we called Roll. We want to go from renting to owning the building to our establishment.
Paying off his 30-year mortgage in only 4 years, the Masjid group from 10. Debt and developed into a mainstay and symbol of stability in the West Oak Lane area. Now, over 30 years. In the fall of 1977, a small group of believers began meeting in the home of Chris Aziz and Safi Kareem.
And either that, our first location was on 16th and Fitzwater Street. We were at the Scottish Rites. And what happened is that we were there, but we always wanted to have our own place because we felt that the only way we could have all of the fully function of a masjid, we had to grow and develop.
After 2 years of conducting meetings at the Philadelphia Gas Works in West Philadelphia and the Scottish House in South Philadelphia, the group was able to rent a space above a pizza shop at Broad and Huntington Park. After much struggle and sacrifice, the young community was able to rent a building on Stanton Avenue in the Mount Airy section of the city.
We were there for about maybe 2.5 years. At that time, several families, and myself included, we put up our homes as our collateral for a building on 7700 Ogun. And this was the first time, and we ended up playing we called Roll. We want to go from renting to owning to building to our establishment.
Paying off his 30-year mortgage in only 4 years, the Masjid grew from 10 families to 200 families, paid off all his debt, and developed into a mainstay and symbol of stability in the West Oak Lane area. Now, over 30 years later, Masjidullah has taken its next big step. In May 2013, Masjidullah purchased the West Oak Lane Church of God in Christ for $1 million. The acquisition of this property was made possible through contributions of hundreds of supporters, including many non-Muslims.
The feasibility study, seeking the opinion of the believers, of the members, whether or not they'd be willing to support the acquisition of this place at a 7401 Lincoln Pike. And when we explained to them that it was going to be a major acquisition, there would be much more sacrifice, and 88% of the people agreed to commit themselves to making those sacrifices and what necessary to do that.
Helping to facilitate this transition was the Ogun's Avenue Revitalization Corporation. The campus includes a prayer area,
that can accommodate between 1,000 and 1,500 people, a banquet hall that can host 300, and a 14-classroom school capable of serving 300 students. This new facility will enable Masjidullah to educate our own children by providing a safe, Islamically-based education program to serve as a citywide masjid or grand masjid that works for the unity of the Muslim community and be a unifying force in building alliances with other faith and community groups. The move marked the completion of raising $260,000 for phase one of the renovation plan. This phase in the history of Masjidullah has been considered the pray and eat phase. Now, with thousands of dollars of renovations completed, with a magnificent prayer area, banquet facility, state-of-the-art commercial kitchen, and school, Masjidullah begins phase two, which is to educate and elevate, and opens the Center for Human Excellence to the world.
Imam Shabada said, we want to have, first of all, obviously religion, but also education, also political, also social and cultural. So having these things in place now, by Allah's grace, we're able now to have a fully functioning Islamic institution that can reach out and be a service, not only to the Muslims, but also to the general, our community, because we felt that we have a God-given mission to bring our message of family life and wholesome living to all of the human family. Thank you.
get this straight.
Yes.
Lactate is 100% real milk.
Right, real milk.
But it won't cause me discomfort.
Exactly, because it's milk without the lactose.
And it tastes?
It's real milk. Come on, would I lie about this? Lactate, 100% real milk, no discomfort.
One place where you can get 50 to 60% off BMW, Mercedes-Benz, and Porsche models? Click on the video now. E-Imports for Less is the only discount center for high-line vehicles on the entire East Coast. We offer only the finest hand-picked luxury pre-owned cars. click here to grab 57% off BMWs right now. We even offer financing and trade-in options. That's right, we buy cars.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we'd like to bring forward to the microphone our brother Imam Siraj Wahaj. He's a noted Islamic scholar and community activist. And along with him will be Brother Michael Rashid, the former president and CEO of AmeriHealth Caritas. We'd like to welcome them to the stage now.
By far the most important person that's been in my life has been my dad.
Hey, my grandfather, Edgar Smith.
It had to be my dad.
Basically, he was my father figure in my life. He did a lot of things for me, helped to raise me.
You know, he raised five kids. You know, all of us went to college, you know, graduated. He's
Brothers and sisters, in 1990, I was blessed to witness the first African-American mayor in New York City, David Dinkins. We had a very wonderful relationship with him. And I remember one day he invited us to his house for dinner. And he shared with us a conversation that he had with his wife, Joyce, that had been married at that time over 30 years. He said, "Joyce, aren't you honored that you married me, the first African-American mayor of New York City, rather than that construction worker that you used to be interested in?" She looked at him and said, "Dave, had I married that construction worker, he would have been the mayor of New York City." Tonight, we have come here to raise funds for our beloved Masjidullah. Brother Minister Farrakhan,
life
I want
rough.
To be honest
your
with
fancy
you.
Fancy craft beer is not a fancy craft.
I have a
beer.
Major
but just
dilemma
think,
right now.
If you were a cyborg.
It is.
But you're not a cyborg.
And my dilemma is this.
Ruffles for the rough life.
Brother Minister, I want to hear you. I can't wait to hear you. I don't want to talk. I want to listen to you. But I can't right now. Because I got to raise this money. Really, if it wasn't for my love for that Imam, the Minister Shabazz, I would say to you, "Assalamu alaikum, take my seat. Here's Minister Farrakhan." That's what I want to do. But I decided that I want to make a contribution tonight. I would like to raise, by Allah's permission, from this group tonight, $300,000. Not a whole lot of money. But not only do we want to raise $300,000, I think we can. I want to raise it in a record amount of time, minutes. How is it possible? I have met some of the most generous people as I travel around the country. The most successful fundraiser, I think, was in a little city called Elmira. We raised that night $500,000. But the most significant thing about it, we raised it among 56 people. Last year, we were in Memphis, Tennessee, for the Memphis Muslim Center. Raised that night $950,000. In December, this past December, an organization, a masjid in Dallas, called the East Plano Islamic Association, we raised $1.3 million. A few months ago, not far from here, in Maryland, Dar es Salaam community, Al Huda School. That night we raised close to $1 million. There was one brother sitting there so impressed by what he saw, he wrote a check for $1 million. We raised $2 million that night. I ain't asking you for $2 million tonight, nor $1 million. But $300,000. This is how I intend to get it, by Allah's permission. Brother Imam Shabazz, I don't know if you ever heard of the poor righteous. When they mentioned the poor righteous, they were talking about me. So I ain't got a lot of money. But let me tell you what I'm gonna do. Brother Imam, this is from me. It's a check for $1,000. another commitment for another $1,000, that's $2,000. My wife always matches me, so I pledged $2,000 for her. My masjid is not very rich, but I pledged for my masjid $1,000. That's $5,000. I ain't finished yet, don't clap. Don't stop me. If you clap, I'll stop. And Imam, I pledge for this masjid another $5,000. That's $10,000 from your brother, and you can take it to the bank because our word is bond. I thought, if there are 10 people here, in 2 minutes, can commit in your heart to give $10,000, that would be one third of what we need. Why should you? Why should you, going to another masjid, why should you give to this masjid? As a Christian, why would you donate to a masjid? Because when you look at Masjidullah, it's not just a masjid. If you look at that building, it's a school, it's a nursery, it's a gymnasium, and all of those things that it does. And I remember Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, told us about people in a boat, a ship. And there were good people and bad people in the ship. And the bad people started putting a hole in the ship. And the Prophet said, peace and blessing be upon him, if you let that person go, they would destroy themselves and destroy you. If you hold their hands, you will save them and you save yourself. That's what Masjidullah is all about. Brother Imam, the best donation that I've made, the best investment that I made came 32 years ago. We decided to build a masjid in Brooklyn, in one of the worst areas of the city. Abandoned buildings, 15 crack houses. We spent $25,000 at an auction and purchased that building. If you look at it now, we have no more abandoned buildings. All the crack, all the drugs are gone, and over 40 Muslim businesses on that block alone. And the people of the area bear witness what we have done. So, I pause now for 2 minutes and ask, who will join me and make a commitment for Masjidullah of $10,000? Allahu Akbar. Minister Farrakhan. My brother. Brother Minister, may Allah bless you. Allahu Akbar. That's two. Who will join this party? Help me, those around. Anyone, 10,000? 10,000 from Mecca. MashaAllah. Where's Mecca? Mecca's me. Oh, you're Mecca. MashaAllah. That's three. Who'll be the fourth one? I only have 2 minutes for this. The fourth one who will give $10,000. I believe that if we get 10, we get $300,000 easily. Now, brother, in table number 40, you. No. I know. Brother and sister, I have a rule. When I'm asking for money, don't be waving at nobody. It's going to cost you $10,000. I'm going to let you go this time, but don't do it again. The fourth person of $10,000, brothers and sisters, let's do it. Take away the name Masjidullah for a second and call it Baytullah, the house of Allah. I'll be honest with you. Tonight, what we get is already written. You will not get one penny more or one penny less. But the question is, did Allah write your name down as a giver tonight? My last call, who will give $10,000? Last call? Where? Allahu Akbar, number four, mashallah. May Allah bless you, the best of this life and the best of the hereafter. Say ameen. Brothers and sisters, remember this. I believe in the motto of the Congressional Black Caucus. The motto of the Congressional Black Caucus is, black people have neither permanent enemies nor permanent friends, just permanent interests. It is in our interests to build this community, to get this parking lot, and to see them develop. I want to get one more person, let me tell you why. We have four. And the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said, Bunya al-Islamu ala khams. Islam is built on five. So you can't stop at four. So I need one more person who make a commitment of $10,000. And that would be half of what I asked for. Last call. وَمَا تُنْفِكُمْ مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَلِأَنْفُسِكُمْ Allah says in Quran that whatever of good you spend is for yourself, is for us tonight. Last call, who will give $10,000? Who will share with what Allah has given to you for this project here in Philadelphia? Last call. Okay, good. Alhamdulillah. That's $40,000. If you can't do $10,000, if you can't do $10,000, at least 10 of you should be able to do $5,000. If Allah has given it to you, why not spend it in His way? Why not say, you know what? Allah bless me. I have enough for myself. I want to help my brother because they came here tonight. We have this dinner here tonight to raise money. They need money for this institution. You can't fight institutions with people. You fight institutions with other institutions. And here is one. Who would give $5,000? Let me see it quickly. There's one. Allahu Akbar. Raise them up high. I want to see 10 quickly. We have a sister there. Sister, may Allah bless you. The best of this life and the best of the hereafter. Say ameen. Who else? $5,000. Quickly. Quickly. $5,000? Yes? Where? Where? Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of something. Brother number 37, table 37. But no, don't be going like this. I gave you the rules, brother. I don't want to have to tell you again. Don't be waving them. You're getting me excited up here. Who else to do $5,000? MashaAllah. Number 37, Allahu Akbar. May Allah bless you. The best of this life and the best of the hereafter. Say, I mean, two is good, but I want more. I want 10 people, inshallah, quickly to raise your hand. 5,000, brothers and sisters, you will never, ever, ever forget it. I want to remind you what the Prophet said. He said, a sadaqah burhan, sadaqah, given charity, is a proof. It's a proof of your faith. If you faith, have faith in Allah the Almighty, you will give. We have two. I need more. Last call, $5,000. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you about a verse in Quran that I read that blew my mind.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Wa ma min dabbatin fil ardi illa Allah rizquha.
There is not one animal on earth except Allah has taken upon himself to give it its sustenance. Let's see if it makes sense. What is the biggest animal on earth that we know? The blue whale. 100 feet long, with a life expectancy of 85 years, that have a tongue the size of an elephant and the heart the size of an automobile. And yet this blue whale eats every day. And you know what they eat? They eat krill, this shrimp-like animal. And you know how many krill they eat every day? 40 million krill, weighing 4 tons. And they eat this every day. Allah will feed you if you work hard. Who will give $5,000? Five. Last call. Is that just two people? Is that two people?
Two people.
That's it? I ain't worried. Number three, mashallah. Sister, may Allah bless you. The best of this life and the best of the hereafter. Say I mean. Three is good, but I want more than three people with $5,000. Some of you here have it. We need it. Help your Muslim brother by giving and partnership with them. Last call? Not a problem. And guess what? Brother Minister, I still think we're going to get $300,000. I'm going to show you in 1 second. Finally, how many of you can't do 10,000? You can't do 5,000, but can do $2,500, $2,500. Raise your hand and let me count. $2,500. Apparently, this is everyone here is the poor righteous also. 2,500? Not a problem. The rest of you, let me tell you what I want. All I want is $20. Can you do $20? Raise your hand if you can do $20. $20. $20. $20. $20. All right. All I want is $20 a week. What did I say? I didn't say nothing. I said $20 a week. If you think about it, $20 a week for a year is $1,000. Tonight, we want to make history. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to take a shot in the dark. Faith. I think that there are 300 people here would be a record who can afford to give $20 a week. I know you have a lot of obligations. You have a lot of obligations in the temple, in the mosque, the masjid. I know you do. Your schools, your organizations, your businesses. I know that. But today I want you to make history in the city of Philadelphia. And I'm going to count 300 people that's going to make a commitment of $1,000. You can write a check one time. You can write $500 of it. You can even do a part of it or all of it. I'm going to count to three, seriously, and ask yourself the question, how committed are you to help your brother and sister? Never forget what the prophet said. He said, I swear by it. Man naqasa ma'lu abdin min sadaqa. Wealth is never decreased by giving charity. Never. Okay? Raise your hand and let me count. I need a mic that I can walk with. This, where? brothers and sisters, I'm going to start over here. I ain't looking at nobody. I want to see how many people will make the intention, the niyyah, to get $1,000 for this masjid. I'm going to count to three, and I want you to raise your hand, and I want to count 300 people. One, two, three. Raise your hand. Let me start counting. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 23, 24. I'm going to keep counting you, sister. Keep your hand up. I counted you five times already. How many is that? 20? 20? 4, 25, 26, 26, 27. I'm not even coming over there. 28. I'm not coming over there yet. We got 28, 29. I want more. More from this group here. We got 29. I want more. I want you to show your faith tonight. Reconciliation is one thing. Money is the same thing. We got 29. 30. It's good. I want more. Not satisfied. We got 30. That's it? I should go to my favorite group over here? This group here. Raise your hand. 31. This whole group here, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, mashallah. Now brother, 41. Brother, you had two fingers, that means 2,000? Oh, okay, let me make sure. That's 41, I want more. 42, 43, good, I want more. 43, 44, Allahu Akbar, I want more. You wanna be 45, number 45, Allahu Akbar. 45, I want more. Fisa bidillah, spin in the way of Allah. Haridil mu'minina ala al-kital. Allah tells the Prophet, make them fight. Make them give. 45. I want more. This group here. 45. 45. You put your hand up already. I didn't count you. 46. 47. All right. This wonderful group here. We got 47 so far. 48. This whole group here, this whole group, we got 48. That's 48,000, 49. Good. Who'll be the 50th one here? Number 50, Allahu Akbar. One more. 50 is okay. 51. 51 is okay. But we want more. 51. 51, who else? $20 a week. 51. Anyone else on this side? Should I come there? Yeah? She's raising the hand. Let me tell you the rules. If the baby raises a hand, mom and dad gotta pay. 51. Who else? 52, 53, Allahu Akbar. 53, 54, Allahu Akbar. Just give me 50. Just give me 60. We got 54. 56 is a good number. We got 54. 54, 54, 54, 55. All right, we got 55, mashallah. We got 55. All right, by the time I get to the stage, we want to bring the minister on. We got 55, alhamdulillah. I want more. Anyone else? Anyone want to add to it?
It's okay.
We got 55. 55. Alhamdulillah. Last call? Yes. Yes, you don't have the pledge cards. You don't have the pledge cards going around? The pledge cards don't have them going around?
Yes, yes.
Now, brothers and sisters.
This is in everybody's book.
Okay, everybody's book, brother Imam, look in your books. They're in all the books. Now, brothers and sisters, in my conclusion, we have to bring the minister on. But I wish somehow we could say that if you want to Here, the minister, you got to pay some more money. But I can't, Brother Minister, I can't do it. I want to do it, but I'm tempted, but we can't. If you can't do $20 a week, how about $10 a week? Allah has blessed us. We've saved so much money from how we used to waste money. Can we use that money and spend it on the masjid? That's $500. Who would commit $500? Help me by raising your hand if you would commit $500. That's one. Brothers and sisters, don't hold back. Yeah, Ibn Adam. Yeah, Ibn Adam. This is God speaking. Yeah, Ibn Adam. All children of Adam. And thick spin. Un thick alik. I will spend on you. The whole Quran and the Sunnah is about jumlatul shartiyah, conditional sentences. It's condition. There's no such thing as unconditional love. It's based on conditions. Now Allah wants to test us. How does He test us? He tests us in wealth. And the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said, every nation has had a trial, and the trial of my ummah is money, is wealth. Spin, number two, 500. Good, number three. Spin, brothers and sisters. You know how the early companions were tested? They were tested in the defense of the religion by giving their lives and also spending. Now, we are no different now. We have to spend in the way of Allah. We got three people that 500, number four. I'm going to take 2 minutes, and you can stop me at 2 minutes and see how many people we get in 2 minutes. We got four. Who else? Five. Raise your hand. Five, six. Six people in this side for $500. Be part of this, brothers and sisters. Be partnership with this. Five, six. Six. 500? Seven, seba, 500, eight, Allahu Akbar. Don't stop. If you can't do 500, Brother Rashid told me that it would be nice if some tables can give $3,000, right? 3,000? We have any great table here who want to give a commitment of $3,000 as a table? Would you like to talk to one another? No? You don't want to talk to each other?
That's what those envelopes, the big envelopes are for. Put the money
in. Oh, that's what the big envelopes are for.
Put the money in the envelope.
Put the money in the envelope. All right, brother and sister, listen. I'm not gonna beat you tonight. If you can't do 500, hold up. Hold up. If you can't do 500, whatever you can do in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do it. Spin. Can I ask you one question before I go? I'm sitting down looking. I'm finished. I'm on my way. That's me walking down here right now. I'm going to my table. Can we play a little game? Can we play a game for just 1 minute? Brothers and sisters, can I get your attention? Can I get your attention? See, I know this is not the fun part. See, this is not the fun part. This is the business part. It's very serious, and they need our help. Can I see how many people can do even 100? I'll give 100 right now. Let's see how many we can count. Let's see if we get a crazy number. One, two, three. Four, five, six, seven, mashallah. Seven, $100. Eight, nine, Allah Akbar. 10, Allah Akbar. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, $100. 16, 17, $100. $100. 18, 19, $100. 19, 20, $100. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 25, $100, 26, 27, 27, $100. Don't think, brothers and sisters, that ain't much. Allah record everything you do. Whoever does an Adam's worth of good shall see it. Last call. Shadid, Shahid, what table is that? What table? Oh, okay. Did you say something for $100? You said something? Maybe I missed you. You said 100? Huh? I'm hearing things. All right. I'm finished. Brothers and sisters, may Allah bless you. We're going to count the money. Some of you are shy. You don't want to raise your hand. That's fine. We count the money and we let you know. Thank you so much. And Brother Minister Farrakhan, I want to thank you again for all the great work that you do, for your leadership, all that Allah has blessed you with. Looking forward to hear you. And the only reason I'm stopping now is I want to hear you. May Allah bless you. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Imam. Thank you so much, Brother Imam. Thank you. So now I am standing between you and Minister Farrakhan, and I hate to do that, but we want to make sure that you have a chance to give the money that you raised your hand up and said you were going to give. So we're asking the oldest person at every table to collect the money that you were going to give. The oldest person at every table. Don't be ashamed. It's good to be old. The oldest person at every table, collect, and we're looking for $3,000 per table. That oldest person, collect the money and write on the outside of the envelope how much you have collected. Please. Our hostess are going to come around and get that envelope from you. Please listen carefully. I have one more thing I want to say, and you can hear Minister Farrakhan. Please listen carefully. Please listen carefully. Please listen carefully. Most of the money that was pledged tonight was a pledge. You held your hand up and you said, I'm going to give. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. We are going to make it very easy to document your pledge. You don't have to go to a room or anything and write down anything. All you have to do is text your pledge. How many of you know how to text? Everybody knows how to text, right? Text messages is the biggest thing in the world now, is text messaging. We have made it available to you to text a pledge, and we will follow up with you on the pledge. So all of you who raised your hand, there is a piece of paper in your book that explains to you how to do it. I want to ask you all right now, pull out your cell phones, please. And I will be off this stage. Pull out your cell phones, please. Everybody who has a cell phone, pull out your cell phone. You know how to text. And just like you're texting, in the part of your phone where you text to someone, you can put the number 41444. It's up here on our thermometer. 41444. And in the message part, you type the word child, because we are trying to control the education of our children. In the message part, type the word child, and then put a space, and put how much you raised your hand and said to the imam that you were going to pledge. Put that dollar amount in that right there. So you put child, space, the amount. And you can put your name after it, or you don't have to put your name after it. We can follow up with your cell phone number. Does everybody understand that? If you don't understand that, we have hostesses that can help you pledge a number. But it's as simple as 41444 to child, and the word child in the message, space, how much you want to pledge to help Masjidullah. If you are giving cash, please listen carefully. If you are giving cash, please put your cash in the small envelope that is in your book, put your name on it, and put that in the larger envelope so we can follow up with you and give you a receipt. At that point, please turn the large envelope with the total of how much your table has collected into the hostess. Please remember, text your pledge to 41444 and put the word child in the message. Space how much you are pledging. We want to thank you all so much for helping us out. I'd just like to say that we were able to acquire this masjid not just because of Muslims. There were many, many, many non-Muslims who contributed to us to obtain this masjid. I want to tell you, as I said yesterday when we cut the ribbon, when we first started raising money for this masjid, the first dollar that we got was from a non-Muslim, and that was from Representative Vanessa Brown, who is right here. The first $1,000 we got was from Vanessa Brown. The most dollars that we got when we were raising money from the masjid was from my good friend, Renea Moore. Where is she? She was right here. Renea Moore gave us $10,000. Renea Moore is a minister in the Christian church. She gave the Muslims $10,000. So if they can help us, why can't we help ourselves? All right, let's put our words into action. Let's make our pledges real. Let's fulfill our pledges. And I appreciate you, and I appreciate everything that everyone in this community has done to bring us this far. I want to relinquish the stage to my good brother. First time I heard Islam, it was Minister Farrakhan in 1970, so I have to say I'm a Muslim because this brother brought me the teachings of Islam. So alhamdulillah, Minister Farrakhan, thank you. No, I'm sorry, Mr. Farrakhan, I'm sorry. I'm just acknowledging you. We have to introduce you, please. One second. We have to give you a proper introduction. I got carried away, brother. I'm sorry.
Assalamu alaikum. We want to thank everybody for the generous donations, and a little later on in the program, we will let you know exactly how much we were able to raise. Before we bring on the minister, it's just a few people that we want to recognize. If I can just have everybody's attention. We're so happy and so pleased tonight that in the audience we have Sabrina Fulton, the mother of Trayvon Martin. Would you please stand, please? And we just have a special presentation for her. We're so happy. Thank you for joining us. We love you. We're blessed tonight also to have some of our elected officials. We have City Councilwoman Blondell Reynolds Brown. We have Vanessa Lowry Brown, State Representative. We have, where is it? Oh, here he is. We have the champion, Bernard Hopkins. Hee-haw! He got so many belts, I don't even know which, what is it, light, heavyweight, middleweight? Got them all. Be high. Keep going. Welterweight. We're pleased to have the granddaughter of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Halima Muhammad Ali. Where is she? We also have the nephew of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Rob Muhammad. I see my good friend, William Pooji Hart of the Delphonics. Stand up, please, Poo. We have one of the most prolific songwriters in the history of America, Lukman El Hot, Kenny Gamble. Stand up, Kenny. And we had the next mayor of Philadelphia, Raheem Islam. We're so happy to have all of you here tonight. This is, as I said before, this is a historic occasion. Okay. We also have State Representative Ron Waters, one of our brothers, who's in the house. And we have the best police commissioner that the city has ever known, our brother, Sylvester Johnson. First Muslim police commissioner of Philadelphia. And we got the first one out the limo, Charlie Mack. And we got Commissioner Anthony Clark is also here. And the one and only Ducky Burks. Everybody's here tonight. Okay. And there's one person we definitely got to mention because she really stepped up to the plate to help us get the mosque. And that's the president of United Bank, Evelyn Smalls. Stand up, Evelyn. If you got your money in the bank and it's not United, you got to take care of that on Monday morning. Did I miss anybody? Huh? I'm sure I missed somebody. Okay, and the president of the Sunday Sun newspaper, Jerry Mondesiah. Who's that? Okay, and we got world famous boxing promoter Murad Muhammad from Newark, New Jersey. Where's Murad? We also have the Pennsylvania State Athletic Commission Director, Rudy Battle. We could be here all night, because first of all of you all are special. But you all know why we came here, one of the reasons anyway. We came to hear a man, only man that I know in the world that could call for 1 million black men and 2 million show up. So I'm like Siraj, I'm tired of talking, you know? But before that, I'm gonna bring up our lovely co-host, Sister Nisa, and she's gonna move us along in the program. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. And I'm going to also be very short. But first, one of the things I want to first do is, oh, you're taking my script, thank you, is add my name to the list of people who became Muslim because of the work of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. And I want to thank him for the impact he has had in my life and helping me to become the Muslim that I am and helping me to develop my family. And I just cannot thank Allah enough for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. So, with that, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing to you the person who is going to introduce the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. So, Student Minister Rodney Muhammad was born in Chicago, Illinois, where he grew up on the South Shore neighborhood. He majored in business administration at DePaul University and worked as an estate planner before he entered the Nation of Islam. He is the Delaware Valley Regional Student Minister of Minister Louis Farrakhan, and he has served as the student minister of Mosque No. 12, Top of the Clock, in Philadelphia since 1991. Brother Rodney is a religious leader, but he's also a social activist who readily speaks out about all forms of injustice. I introduce to some and present to others Student Minister Rodney Muhammad. Please welcome him with a warm round of applause.
Assalamu alaikum. In the name of Allah, the beneficent, the merciful, the one God to whom praise is due, the Lord of the worlds, we thank Almighty God, the revealer of all truth, the sender of all prophets, of whom we make no distinction. We do thank him for Moses and the Torah, Jesus and the Gospel, Muhammad and the revelation of the Holy Quran. And as a registered member of the Nation of Islam, of course, I am a student of the life-giving teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And because of that, I am most thankful to Allah for his intervention in our affairs. And the man that came here, Master Farad Muhammad, and made a wise choice for a people who have suffered foolish choices for a 400-year period. He chose a servant for us that is unfailing in his commission in the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a man responsible for producing luminaries that have served the black world since the time of his being raised. We thank Allah for him, but I never met either of those men. I'm eternally indebted to them both for the man that I did meet, their student, their apostle, and their servant, the Honorable Louis Farrakhan. Thank you. I'm so thankful to the Honorable Louis Farrakhan, and you know, I could say how I have benefited since my coming into the Nation of Islam in the year of 1982. And it's been a long walk, but we're a blessed people. And we have never been shortchanged. We should rejoice in our bargain because we cut a good deal, as they said, when we came with him. On behalf of my youngest son, I was blessed to have both of my sons named by the Honorable Louis Farrakhan, and on behalf of my youngest son, Lukman, he sent me a text, and as he struggled with his life, he said, you have really helped him in this last year. He has stacked up videos, books, and everything, and he has really come back into the mosque strong. So I want to thank you for that. You're still helping. Praises be to Allah. I want to thank Masjidullah for taking this bold step. And as I said at the ribbon cutting Thursday, you know, when you are in faith, you got to take the first step. But if you keep your guard lifted, every step you take, you'll find out he already took one. And he's in front of you. And you can't fail, as I heard one saying from the prophet that a man was shown the creation. How could a man fail with something like this? But then he was showed the creation after Shaitan had altered it. And then the question was, how can a man succeed in this? But the time that we are in is a time for the success of the righteous. And our success is tied into the theme of this week, reconciliation. A few definitions of the word reconcile is to render no longer opposed, to win over, to friendliness, to compose or settle an argument or dispute, and finally, to bring into agreement or harmony to make compatible. This is a time of trouble that we're living in now. And this time that we are in is going to take a spiritual walk. We had a service this morning because with spiritual leaders coming in, because I revisited the words of the Honorable Louis Farrakhan from the press club in Washington, D.C. in 1993, that the president really ought to convene spiritual leadership, because America is desperately in need of spiritual rejuvenation. People are tiring of religion, not because religion is necessarily wrong. They're tiring of religion because they're seeking a higher manifestation of the truth. And too often we are pushing them in rituals, ceremonies, and traditions that only hide the greater truth that's stored up inside of them. The root, the Honorable Louis Farrakhan teaches us, of our problem today is spiritual, so it's going to necessitate a spiritual solution. That's the time that we're in. And because we have lost our way, we have to come out of a time of 6,000 years of paradigm where we learned about God, and we start in a new paradigm where we learn directly from God. That means that there has to be a submission to God who has a perfect knowledge of the time and the season that we're in. And so as I just recount some of the words that the Honorable Louis Farrakhan shared with us and what his energy has brought us between the year 1995 and the year 2005, some reconciliation took place. The Million Man March was a call to reconcile men to God. Then the women stepped forward so women could be reconciled to men and sisters reconciled to each other. And then the youth had a Million Youth March in Harlem, New York, and Atlanta, respectively, to be reconciled back with the parents. And then in the year 2000, the family was convened in Washington, D.C. again. And then in the year 2005, the Honorable Louis Farrakhan called us back to Washington, for those that remember, to bring our churches and to bring our mosques and to bring our organizations into harmony with each other and to reconcile with each other, because everybody has something to bring to the table. The time that we're in, where people who were with Malcolm could not walk with people who were with King, but the time we are in has reconciled the arguments of both men, because we got the pictures of both men in our homes. The time that we are in is reconciling differences, because those are the forces that are working with us today. And I just want to say that this time requires a vessel. A vessel is a man who harmonizes with the time and can bring into agreement those that are in disagreement and those that were opposed one to the other. He cannot harmonize with the time except he gives up all that he has and gives up all that he is. I thank Allah for the Honorable Louis Farrakhan, because that's the kind of sacrifice that has been made so that you and I can be blessed today. I thank you. As the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, he would raise a spiritual son in this part of our planet from himself. So if anybody would ask, when will we see the Father, his response will be, have I not been with you all of this time? Yea, when you see me, you see the Father, because we were told when you see him, look at him. When you hear me, you are hearing the Father, because when he speaks, you are hearing the man that he gave up everything for and gave up what he was to become like him. So I say to you, beloved, we are a blessed people because a spiritual son is among us. And so I hope and pray that you watch this video that we have, a short video that bios the man that's about to come. And right after that short video, the voice you hear will be the Honorable Louis Farrakhan. Thank you again, beloved. Assalamu alaikum.
Why are you in Baghdad, Minister Farrakhan? Baghdad is the focus of the world because the clouds of war hover over this great city, and the winds of war are threatening not only this city and nation, but this entire region, which could lead to a war that could engulf the entire world. Came over the news this morning that the Justice Department of the United States government condemned my visit to Libya. Why? Am I a slave? Is America a plantation that I must seek permission from my government to visit my own brothers?
His words resonated with people around the globe. He touched the hearts of audiences everywhere with a healing from the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad for every condition or circumstance he encountered.
You must not bow down to the English. You must not bow down to America. We must bow down only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I've seen Africans that have graduated from Al-Azhar with doctorate degrees serving young Kuwaiti Arabs who don't have a degree.
That is true. That is true.
Talk back to me.
Go ahead, sir.
Is this the way we should degenerate?
No, sir.
Is this the way we should be as Muslims?
No, sir.
An inferior group so that if we're with the Pakistanis, we want to be Pakistani?
No, sir.
We're with the Arab, we want to be an Arab?
No, sir.
We're with somebody else who got it, we want to be like them? No. Why don't you want to be your African self?
Allahu Akbar. That's it! That's it! That's it!
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise up and put your hands together and give a rousing welcome to our beloved brother minister, the Honorable Louis Farrakhan.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, we give him praise and thanks for his mercy and his goodness to all of the members of the human family, that whenever any member of this family strays from his straight path and earns his displeasure, before he punishes, he always raises from among that people a messenger or a prophet to whom he gives what is called divine revelation, by means of which he can guide that people back to his favor. We thank Allah as Muslims for all of the prophets, and we make no distinction between them. For Allah has given some prophets more degrees of wisdom and eminence, but all are one prophetic community. So in Islam, we honor all of the prophets, those that we know and those that we don't know, for they're all from one source. We thank Allah for Abraham, who is the father of monotheistic tradition of the present world. We thank him for Musa or Moses and the Torah. We thank him for Jesus or Isa and the Injil or Gospel. We thank him for Prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah, through whom he sent into this world its final revelation, the revelation of the Quran. Peace be upon these worthy servants of Allah. I am a student of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and I could never thank Allah enough for his merciful intervention in our affairs. In the person of Master Farad Muhammad, we thank him for his coming. We thank him for his wise choice of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad to start us on a journey to Allah and to Islam and to the universality of Islam. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad had a specific function, and it started in a narrow focus on the condition that white America had imposed on black people. That condition, unfortunately, still remains with many of our people, a condition of self-hatred, where no matter how well we try to be together, there's always something among us that stops our unity, thereby impeding the power that we need to make the progress that is demanded of us in this time. I thank Allah for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I would not be able to do anything that I have been blessed to do were it not for him and the guidance that he gave me when I didn't even know he was planting seeds that would germinate later into actual guidance to rebuild his work. His work was necessary then. His work is necessary now. But none of us could be Muslims without a foundational knowledge of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So I thank Allah for Imam W.D. Muhammad, the son of Elijah Muhammad, who had a very specific work to do that would put us further on the path of the universality of the teachings. Elijah Muhammad said to me one day, he said, "Brother, they call me a black nationalist." He said, "Brother, black is not national. Black is universal. For everything started in darkness and then came out into the light." I want to share with you, beloved, how honored I am to be here to help in the inauguration of Masjidullah in its current form. We donated tonight $10,000, but I want all who said that we would donate, have you not heard that your word shall be born regardless of whom or what? Yes, our word is bond, and bond is life. And we will give our life before our word shall fail. It is a word and living up to that word that develops trust. And the greatest characteristic that we could develop is honesty. Because without honesty and truthfulness, we can never fulfill our pledge. And we make a pledge to Allah in our prayers when we say, "My prayer, my sacrifice, my life and my death is all for Allah, the Lord of the worlds." I am honored to be here tonight because this is something that has been in the works for nearly 40 years. That we who came apart for whatever reason in due season would find our way back to each other, because we are Muslims. And even though we had serious disagreements, it never caused us to shed the blood, the precious blood of another Muslim. The whole world of Islam can learn from our example. I greet all of you with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. To Imam Shabazz, words are not adequate to say thank you. for inviting us to be a part of the great work of this community, most of whom are followers of Imam W.D. Muhammad, who came through the Nation of Islam. But I want you to know that Imam W.D. Muhammad and I are brothers. He and I were friends as young men in Islam. And when we sat together in Boston, where I was the young minister, he came and spent time with me. He was so sensitive to the hurt of believers who had to get out on the corner and sell the newspaper, and sometimes they were pushed out, so to speak, against their will. And the imam was so sensitive. And when he spoke to me about believers having papers in their cars, having papers in their basements, having papers under the bed that never got out to the people, I wrote the Honorable Elijah Muhammad a letter and said, I have to give up the ministry. And I heard that the messenger took my letter and threw it in the garbage pail, and I'm glad he did. It was Imam W.D. Muhammad that taught me Salat. It was Imam W.D. Muhammad who revised the play that I wrote in 1956 called Organa, A Negro Spelled Backwards. The language of it was, you know, kind of rough. And he refined it for me. And we put it on in Symphony Hall in Boston and Carnegie Hall in New York, Town Hall, and we played here in Philadelphia. Imam W.D. Muhammad was a spiritual giant among the ministers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Malcolm X was the great preacher of Elijah Muhammad. And W.D. Muhammad was one that Malcolm would listen to. And all of us would listen to, because he was deeply spiritual and deeply sensitive. He was sent here to Philadelphia, and the mosque grew under his leadership. But I can't be in Philadelphia and not mention Brother Malcolm, because Malcolm came here to Philly in the early, early days. And he was painting somebody's house. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad sent him a letter, say, do you want to paint the walls of houses or the hearts of men? And Malcolm went into the ministry, and Mosque number 12 got its name. And a young man named Brother George. Some of you may remember Brother George. He was a great young teacher. He gave me my first Schofield Bible, all marked up with all the verses that we preached from. And then under Brother George was Captain Jeremiah. And later, Jeremiah became the minister. And we being in New York, that's where I came in, we were always clashing, you know, who was the best drilling team. And Jeremiah would come with his soldiers and Yusuf Shah with his soldiers. And everybody was admiring the discipline of the early followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. They paid a price that we could be here today. Many of them stood up when the mosques were attacked by the police under the inspiration of the FBI. We learned that we had to fight for Islam. And there were no punks in the FOI or the MGT. We fought and we won most all our fights unarmed against armed enemies that wanted to destroy the nation of Islam. I just want us to remember the way we were. Let's, you know, don't ever condemn the road that you walked over to get where you are today. Because if it were not for that time, there wouldn't be this time. If it were not for Elijah Muhammad, we would not have had Imam Warithuddin Muhammad. If it were not for Elijah Muhammad, we wouldn't know nothing about Malcolm X or Muhammad Ali. All of us are students of a great teacher that the world wants to lift the students and hide the teacher of us all. That's the work of the enemy. Hiding the man who is the source of our inspiration. Now some say, well, yeah, but that was a period of, the teaching was darkness. I understand. But I also want you to understand. Have you ever watched the sunrise? Go out some morning and just watch the sun rise. You don't see the sun first. You see rays of light. Darkness still prevailing, but the rays of light say, lighter is coming. And degree by degree, the sun rises. Then it's darkness mixed with light. And then the darkness is gone. And the only thing left is the brightness of the day. Allah's Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, raised a nation by degrees. This Quran was not given to him at once. Over 23 years. Do you remember how it started? The Muslims in the early days were praying and they were drunk. Can I get a witness, somebody? Then the Quran says, go not near prayer when you're intoxicated. At that time, prayer was twice a day until the prophet's night journey. And it would have been 50 prayers if Moses hadn't been troubled by Jibril to keep going back to God. But every one prayer became the value of 10. I thank Allah for Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the path that he laid down. And I want to recite a few things that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to me that makes this moment so historic. When he said that Master Farad Muhammad gave him 104 books to study, and the best of those books was Quran. And when Master Farad Muhammad met him, he gave him an Arabic Quran. And he said, but I can't read it. And Master Farad said, read. He said, but I can't read. Elijah Muhammad did not know that he was going over the steps of Prophet Muhammad himself. And if you really study the motion of Islam in America, we are absolutely going over the steps of the Prophet himself. The persecution of the Muslims. Did we suffer that? Did many of us go to prison rather than fight in unjust wars in America? Did we do that? Will we do it again? When the Israelis are pushing America to go to war with Iran. Over what? Well, they're trying to make weapons of mass destruction. Who said so? The same liar that told us that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction. Did we find them? And how many American children have died on the basis of a lie? But who is strong enough? Don't tell me that Allah is the power and you're afraid now to speak truth to the powers that be. Either he is in your life or he's not, because this is no game to be played today. Excuse me. In the Quran, it reads, O you who believe, keep your duty to Allah as it ought to be kept, and die not unless you are Muslims, and hold fast by the covenant of Allah altogether, and be not disunited. And remember Allah's favor to you when you were enemies. Then he united your hearts, so by his favor you became brethren. And you were on the brink of a pit of fire, then he saved you from it. Thus, Allah makes clear to you his messages that you may be guided. Why is the Ummah divided so terribly today? That Muslims are killing Muslims, judging
who is or who is not. Who put on you the robe of Allah that you can sit as a judge over who is and who is not? Allah says he knows best who is and who is not. And Allah already knew we would have differences, but he said he will settle the differences between the believers. Dear Muslims, we have an opportunity today to be an exemplary community of not what Islam looks like, but what Islam is. You know, prayer is wonderful because it's our way of communicating with our Creator. But when prayer becomes a ritual and loses its significance, when we pray and we're not mindful of what we're saying, and most importantly, to whom we're saying it, Shaitan can make salat. And those of us who look on the outside say, ah, good brother. It reminds me of the book of Job in the Bible. To my Christian friends, the sons of God went to present themselves before God, and guess who was walking with them? Satan. And you can imagine how they felt when God said, whence cometh thou, Satan? And the sons of God looked around and said, hey, I didn't know this dude was dead. No, that's a modern translation. But he asked Satan, whence cometh thou? And Satan spoke boldly. I came from walking up and down, to and fro in the earth, seeking whom I may devour. Question for us. Are we really the servants of Allah? Or have we been devoured by a clever shaitan? We got to think now. Look at the argument in the Quran between Satan and God. Satan says to Allah, respite me till the day when they are raised. Think over the word raised. I know Imam, my beloved brother, he knows the Arabic so perfectly. Respite me till the day when they are raised. Raised how? Because there's got to be something missing if you are walking with Satan, thinking you're walking the walk of faith, and the Satan has made evil fair seeming to us, where we now can get along by going along with same-sex marriage. This is all right now. And you can't stand up on what God has revealed in both the Bible, the Torah, the Gospel, and the Quran. It doesn't mean you don't love your brother or sister who is deviant. But how many of us are holy? How many of us would be where we are if Allah did not forgive us?
and show us mercy. That's why this meeting tonight is so important, because it comes just in front of our Ramadan. I heard a beautiful word from Imam this morning, and he said that feeling has to come back to us. Whew. He said, we don't feel for each other. Wait a minute. You mean you could see a Muslim with an AK-47 shooting at another Muslim? And one Muslim is saying, Allahu Akbar. And the other one is firing back saying, Allahu Akbar. If you can't feel the pain of a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew or an agnostic who is dying under unjust circumstances, then you're numb or dead. Respite me till the day when they are raised. And Allah said, surely you are of the respited ones. And what did Satan say? He said, I'm going to come after them. Them who? The followers of your prophets. I'm going to come after them in what? Sirat al-Mustaqim. I'm coming after them in the straight path. And I'm going to come to them from before them, from behind them, from their left side and from their right side. And I'm going to make all of them what? And Allah said, whoever you cause to deviate, I will certainly fill hell with you all. Now look at religion. Has Satan come in the straight path of the prophets and the truths that they taught to divide that community? Come on. Muslims. Allah says in the Quran that they didn't become divided until after knowledge came to them, splitting up their religion into sects and parties due to envy among them. Why won't we support Masjidullah? Well, I'm an imam, and I have my mosque too, and I ain't going to help Masjidullah. I mean, they shine better than me in Philly. Now, don't tell me that kind of stuff don't creep up into the heart. See, that's where Shaitan is. He comes up into the heart and the mind of a believer, and you will not support another believer. See, we support Masjidullah not because of the imam, but because of the work that this mosque is doing for Philadelphia and for the citizens of Philadelphia. I'm almost finished. I'm going to come at them from the left side. Boy, that's heavy. They're going to come directly as your enemy. Hey, but now he's coming from the right side like he's your friend. Oh. Then he goes in front of you when you're trying to do a good work
and lie about your intentions and the good that you desire to do to build up opposition against you. And then he follows up the good that you do with slander and evil. I'm gonna make them all deviate. And in another part of the Quran, similar, he said, you'll get all, Satan, except my purified ones. Question. Are we the purified ones? Just check ourselves out. Are we the purified ones? See, if you're purified, you may try to purify yourself, but all of us need Allah to intercede to purify us for His sake. Now, I'd like to close. I'm excited. You know, I broke down this morning as I looked at the picture of my brother Imam and myself. I have loved him since we were little fellas together. And the most grievous moment to me was when I had to attend his janazah. But he lives. I'm going to say it again. He lives. He lives in the hearts and the minds of everyone that his word has affected. He lives in the hearts and minds of the students that are studying Islam and Arabic because he intervened and brought them a teaching that guided their footsteps. And so it is with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I could not stand by and let the good work that he did be buried.
Yes, sir.
Nor his greatness.
That's right.
Buried.
That's right.
Because we did not understand the step that he had to make. You say, well, he didn't preach universal Islam. We weren't ready for it. He came like Musa came, preaching to a specific people who had a specific sickness. And you cannot say that the medicine that he applied did not begin to heal our wounds that were inflicted on us by white supremacy. And that illness of white supremacy has infected the whole Islamic world. Talk back to me. All of you who have gone into other communities, you felt rejected. You've had those feelings. I was in Mecca at Hajj. Yes, I made Hajj. And I made Umrah 4 or 5 times. In fact, about it, I was mobbed in Mecca like I was a rock star. This is the God's honest truth. Because young Muslims hearing a voice that cries out for justice and is not going to go along to get along with nobody. And if Allah is the one you fear, then there is no fear in you for anybody else. Now, I think you know,
May I take just a few more minutes? This is Masjidullah. You know, Allah didn't come to give us masjids alone. Masjids have a purpose. Look at the second surah when Abraham and Ishmael raised the foundations of Al-Kaaba and they prayed, oh Allah, accept our offering. Huh? Now think of the prayer and make us submissive to thee or make us Muslims. Now listen to the prayer of Abraham. And raise from our offspring a masjid, a temple, a synagogue, a church. Raise from our offspring a nation submissive to thee. Then it talks about Allah sending a messenger to fulfill that command. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, started in Arabia. But as Brother Imam Siraj said at his khutbah, Prophet Muhammad said, peace be upon him, I am the messenger of Allah to you all, to the whole of humanity. But Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the final step in a succession of prophets coming to nations. Huh? So the Quran says, every nation has received a messenger. Not some. Every. Now I'm going to ask you a question. In the Bible, in the book of Genesis, Noah was sent to a people in the Middle Eastern area. And the Bible says the people of that day, every thought and imagination of their hearts was to do evil. So Allah punished them. And then the Bible says, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the future. He sent Lot to the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. And most of us sometimes forget, you know, Allah don't necessarily change himself to please us. We're going to have to conform to please him. Now the people in Sodom and Gomorrah were doing something that no people had ever done before them. And what is that? Males coming to males with lust in their hearts as they would a female. Now what's going on in America? It now even preaches and a president swear on the Bible not to uphold the Bible, but to uphold the Constitution. But why do you put your hand on the Bible and then violate the moral teachings contained in that book? As a president of the United States,
just talking to you now. Who gonna tell him? See, if you're looking for a little handout from the government, you're not gonna talk. Your mouth is sealed because your need for money has crippled your heart. Man, I want to be loved. I know the feeling. It's a hell of a thing to be rejected, to be evil spoken of when your intentions are good. Sure, we all want to be loved, but I would rather be loved by Allah. See, then I know He got my back. And the scripture says, O messenger, deliver the message. And if you do it not, thou hast not delivered the message. But if you do it, know that I surely will protect you from men. I like that. So it makes me more bold. And I mean, I know my company is not liked sometimes, you know. I understand that. If I hang out with Farrahan, maybe the philanthropists will walk by me and I can't have that. So I like you, brother, but I'll see you around the back door at midnight. Brothers and sisters, the Quran says, Allah is sufficient. For the believer, there's nothing that we want that He doesn't control the power to give it to us. And all we have to do is do what He asks us to do. Pray and be grateful for the things that He gives us. And if we are grateful for the things that God has given to all of us, you won't have any time to ponder the little things that are your struggles. And don't think that you shouldn't struggle as a believer in God. If there is no struggle, you'll never know who you are. I gotta say to the B-Hop, this man, he is defying all odds. And it has to be because his faith is not only in his ability to keep his body tuned and his mind sharp in the study of his opponents, but it has to be because of his faith in Almighty God, Allah. And as long as he keeps that faith and looks after his body, I'm sure that he will be the champion that he hopes to be in his next fight, cleaning out the division. And we're with you to do that. Now, I would like to close. Praise the Lord. Allah says in the Quran, you are the best nation raised up for men. You enjoin good, you forbid evil, and you believe in Allah. He didn't say you're the best masjid, the best synagogue, the best church. See? It's a nation in submission to the will of God. That's what he's seeking. As a Christian, Jesus said, on this rock I build. Not a church, but it really is a community, a nation. So I come back to this question. has Satan got us while we proclaim God? Look outside the door. Look at the behavior of our people. Look at the behavior of America. She had no business in Iraq. She can't say she's going over there to set down a tyrant when we living under tyranny. Set yourself down. But you're so powerful and so arrogant, Allah has to do that. And look at how he's whipping the hell out of America. And you haven't seen nothing yet. Now you can say that Elijah Muhammad was off, but he said the judgments of Allah will come against America. Four great judgments: rain, hail, snow, and earthquakes. Well, are they coming? Yes. And it's going to intensify. He didn't say it alone. Jesus said it. Just the beginning of sorrows. When you see pestilence and famine and earthquakes in diverse places and war and rumors of war. You are the best nation. So we have to begin to think like a nation. Nations have to feed their citizens. Nations have to educate their citizens. Nations have to guarantee security of those who embrace that nation. We are in submission to Allah. He is sufficient for us. But many of us, you heard the Honorable Elijah Muhammad teach about how to eat to live. Do you remember those teachings? Well, that book, we threw that away, you know. But what's the results? What's the results? And even if you know how to eat to live, if you're not raising the food that you eat, you won't live too long, because commercial greed is killing the American people and killing the people of the world who feed from these agribusiness giants who are poisoning the people by the beautiful way the food looks, where they can take manure and make it taste like steak. No! I'm not making a joke. Some of you go to McDonald's, right? Don't raise your hands. I might have to charge you $5,000 and give it to my brother. But you love it. Oh, I'm loving it. But what are you eating? Do you know how the food is being raised? See, when you eat a chicken, when you eat a lamb, when you eat steak, you are eating from Allah's creatures that he gives you to eat from. But if they're not fed properly, if they're fed with hormones that grow them faster, and that's the meat you consume, and that's the fish that you eat out of polluted waters, that's the food that is colored and coming out of poisoned earth and corrupt seeds. No wonder we're dying so fast of all these diseases. We as a nation, America is for sale. Did you know that? It's for sale. The FBI building was for sale. And whoever bought it, they would rent it. I said, boy, America's in bad shape. They're selling bridges, toll roads. What if America's for sale and over $1 trillion comes into our hands? How much of it do we own? No, the cotton grew for white folks. Don't you think it'll grow for us? Look at these beautiful dresses that the sisters have on. Beautiful cotton garments and beautiful cloth that we could make ourselves if we got in that business. We got to do something for self. So in closing, may Allah bless Masjidullah. My secretaries here, the check that we pledged will be in the mail tomorrow or Monday, because I love this work and I love the work that the believers are trying to do in the name of Allah. Did you know that in December of 1999, Imam Muhammad, Elijah Jr., his daughter Engina, came to our little farm in Michigan? And we sat down and had lunch together. And in my house, I always sit at the head. If you're the head of your house. But when the imam came, I would not sit at the head of the house. I left that seat open for his dad, and he and I sat across the table from each other like brothers.
Right.
Listen, I asked him, I said, Brother Imam, Savior's Day 2000 is coming up, and I would love that you come and say anything to the members of the nation that Allah would put on your heart, and we will share the day together. And he said, Brother Farrakhan, he said, I will come. I'll have something to say. But on that day, you will carry the day. He came. He brought his wife. Elijah Jr. came. Muslims from both communities came in February. Cold. But it was 70 degrees that day. In February, Allah was smiling that two brothers were coming together. I said to our Muslim brothers and sisters who were there, you know, I know you mean well and you want to see our community rise, but you don't know black people. You didn't hear me. You don't know the ills of our community. It's going to take one from among us to raise us up. So I told them on that day, that will be done by Imam Muhammad and myself. And please, on that day, from Mosque Cares, he donated $5,000 to the Nation of Islam. And believe me, it's an honor for me, on behalf of the nation, to give back what he gave and double it
because we are one community. May Allah bless us. May Allah guide and protect us. May Allah facilitate the way for us to come together and reconcile our differences and be one ummah for the glory of Allah and for the furtherance of the cause of Islam. Thank you for listening. Thank you for inviting me. Assalamu alaikum.
Takbir. 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 Brothers and sisters, we welcome back to the podium our mistress and mister of ceremony, Sister Nisa Islam Muhammad, and Brother Ali Salahuddin.
Can we give Brother Minister Louis Farrakhan another well-deserved round of applause? Now, just before we're going to be dismissed with prayer, so I want you to please hold your seats. Now, the main thing that we're interested in as a result of this tonight is that, what are we going to do from here? What are we going to do as we move forward? Because if we don't do anything after this, then this was just an event. We are looking forward to work, both communities working together to bring Philadelphia back to where it should be. So we're going to ask you to please, those who made commitments, please keep your commitment. Please keep your pledges. Please fulfill your obligation. I wanted to also announce that DVDs of tonight's event, tonight's occasion, are available. Also, we have DVDs available for the ministers meeting or the leadership meeting that took place this morning. Where can they get them? Fine thing. Okay, they'll be right to your left, to my left, your right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
They all will be available for sale. So at this time, what I'd like to do is bring back to the rostrum our beloved mistress of ceremonies, Sister Nisa.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Have you enjoyed your evening? Has this just been a wonderful evening of reconciliation? Please give yourselves a warm round of applause. On behalf of Masjidullah, I would like to thank each and every one of you for coming out this evening and joining us in this spirit of reconciliation and really making the financial sacrifice. As Brother Ali said, please make your word bond. If you said you were going to give, please give. And if you were not able to give tonight, please consider giving again in the future. We have witnessed the reconciliation of a family of Muslims coming together under the banner of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, because there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. May God protect you and deliver you safely back to your homes. Assalamu alaikum, peace be unto you. That's it. That's it.
Brothers and sisters, we'd like to welcome back to the podium to be closed out in dua, prayer, our beloved brother Imam Muhammad Abdul Aleem.
talking to the minister.
There's no announcement. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. Our brothers and sisters, before we leave, let us end today the way we begun it. I know we're all excited and we want to brace each other, but as believers in God, we should always begin and end all our events remembering God, because we never know what could happen. We may not see each other ever again. So I want to close now with a prayer. Assalamu alaikum. I just want to make a comment first, though, that we all aware that the Salat, both Maghrib and Isha Cake, amen. And we tried everything in our power to get the room across the hall, but there was another party, the wedding party here. So we asked Allah to forgive us for making our prayers late. So inshallah, so when you get home, make up your Maghrib and Isha. We were completely aware of this. When anybody said we skipped the prayer, no, the environment, we could not control that. Then inshallah, but I want to now close out with Assalamu alaikum, brothers. Assalamu alaikum. We must realize, no matter how excited we may get, that what will establish us is we are truly people of spirit. That spirit must be controlled. The problem for us is we haven't learned to control our spirit. Some of us does that. And we get so excited, we don't realize that the disciplines of worshiping God require that people know when to focus and when not to focus. Even our salat's only 12 minutes. That's 1 hour a day. So you got the other 23 hours. So we must learn to control our mouths and our thoughts when it comes time to prayer. Because if we don't do that, trust me, somebody else is controlling you. Even when you pray, you have things in your mind that's not about your prayers. And then you realize that, you try, how come I'm not making progress? Because you're not controlling the elements of your own body and your own mind. So it's important. When we say time to pray, we should focus. Allah says, when you are free from your immediate task, still labor hard. So I want to close on that. I want to say that particular prayer. It's chapter 98 of the Quran. I'll say it first in Arabic, then I'm going to say it also in English. And at that point, we will be done. And we know that, alhamdulillah, this is the part of a bigger strategy. You only witnessing the beginning of something that we have been planning for many, many years to move us from being just an emotional-based people to having a direction and a plan for our lives. So this coming together tonight is not the end. We're already discussing ways we can work together. Because if we just come together and you know how we are, party hard and go home and forget about it, next day wake up with a hangover. We ain't about that. We have had a great time tonight, but there's still a lot of work to be done. A lot of work. The condition has not changed because we feel good about each other now. We got to be prepared now to sit down and do some hard look at what we can do, what we each bring to the table, and how we can move forward. If we don't do that, we come back in next year, or the year after, good partying. That's all it'll be the Muslim party before Ramadan. And I know that those of you who are about something new, you don't have no time to waste just feeling good about stuff and still doing bad in your economic, social, and a material life. You want your religion to mean something. So this, what we're doing here tonight, this is no game. The thing that the minister has said, we got to go home and give some thought to it. Why haven't our condition changed even though we know better? What aren't we doing right to keep us in the same condition year after we know? We could analyze the problem 1,000 different ways and end up with the same conclusion. We do nothing about it. So inshallah, we have a team of people in place that we hope to do something about it. And we'll be working with, in fact, I think it's Tuesday, Brother Rahim Islam inviting a group together, come together at Orton Reed High School. We must begin to plan our work and work our plan and execute on that plan. Otherwise, men like the Honorable Minister Farrakhan will live and die. And we'll still be doing what? Finding somebody else to teach us about how bad the problem is. Don't let men like that live their lives, give their whole life for us, and we do nothing but stand around and clap and tack beards and all that. Nobody want to hear that. You wonder, what are you doing with what we've gotten? We've had W.D. Farad, Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Minister Farrakhan, Imam W.D. Muhammad. What have we done with the line of leaders we've had? Why haven't we done more in the world? All right, this is serious. All right, so inshallah, so we wanna pray, but I say again, if your prayers are only empty words, rituals, it'll do nothing for you. You got to pray if you know what you say can be implemented in your life. Then it means something. Let's open our hands together, however you turn to God. A'udhu billahi min shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alam nashrah laka sadrak wa radatna anka wizrak alladhi ankadha dhahrak wa rafatna laka dhikrak. Fa inna ma'usri yusran inna ma'usri yusra fa idha faraqta fansab ila rabbika faraqab. Have we not expanded for you your breasts and raised high the esteem that you held and removed the burden from your back? For verily with difficulty comes ease. Verily with every difficulty comes ease. When you are free from your immediate task, still labor hard. Ameen. That's chapter 94 of the Quran. Go home and read it. Assalamu alaikum.
Indeed.